Hi, good afternoon, friends. Let's proceed further where I had left earlier while discussing about the important guidelines for the critical review for the qualitative studies. I completed with the citation and I told you that I need to come back and understand as to how. Now, you see, there are two things that you can really focus upon. One, as they have said, include the full title, all authors, the full journal title or year, volume number, page numbers, or you can ensure that the things are there. For example, if I go to my world, here let me show you one. This is my Excel sheet which I tried to showcase to all of you yesterday, and we have seen that when I am trying to include, let's say this is my complete paper details that I was trying to read out. Whitman, IR, Agarwal, V, Na, G, Dukes, J, this one, then Whitting, Hoff, then I have got Dewland, etc., etc., 2017. This I have taken care. Now, for example, this is for my reference in the Excel sheet. Now, let's say that I have taken care of all each one of them and I have out here these papers and everything. Now, instead this thing, you know, I do not want to introduce it in my writing. So, what will I do? Let's say this is my working paper. It's a working paper, and let's say this is where I want to insert. What do we do if I have already taken care and introduced, keyed all the relevant details in the management sources? It's easier for me. Let's say I have taken here. This is the image and I want to cite it as to who is the person. It will take a time for me. Just give me a moment. Here we go. And now I want to cite it. Now, how will I cite it out here? Now, simply I know from where it has been taken off. What will I do? I will go to references, number one. Number two, since I know the, I have the insert citation out here. Why is it taking so much? Okay, now this is the one. Now, instead of entering the whole thing, let's say this has been taken from Baker J. Burgeons and everything. What will I do? I'll simply write insert citation. So it will come here. There you go. Okay, you have got, because this is in Harvard, so it won't take the entire thing. It will just pick up Baker et al. 2021. Now, let's say I want to insert this particular table into my writing. What will I do? I will go ahead, I will select it. Let's say for the time being, I'm just trying to go ahead and insert this much. Insert in the sense, I want this thing to be present in my Word file. What will I do? I will open, then Control N. Let me just get that page. It will take a minute for me because there are two, three things which are opened up simultaneously. So here we go. And now I copy paste. Okay. So here it's working right now. That means the paper is being, now here we go. It has been there. Now it has taken, occupied so much of space. Now what will I do? I will click and I will just fit it immediately to the Windows. Here we go. Auto fit to the window, and I got. Now I don't want this whole thing to be there. So what will I do? I will collect this whole thing. Let's say this is Whitman. I can go ahead, I can delete this, and instead of this, what he's saying is that go ahead and now here it will not show because it's a same thing. So let's say here, and I go ahead and let me just it's already there, and let's say this is the appendix and I want to insert it here. So here I go, I import the table. Now it will work because it's on the same sheet. And what will I do? I will just click on this and I will first of all fit the entire table as per the window. It has come. Now I will go, I will select this whole thing. Okay, I will delete it. Let's say go to citation and I know where this is, that is Whitman. And now I always do this. Okay, now here comes Whitman here and I will enter. Now you will see the reference. Either you can write reference here, or if you want you can write citation for the same thing. So you will be coming up with this kind of thing. If in case you don't want this and you are just focusing on the reference and you want citation, you can include the citation out here. This is what I wanted to showcase to you, wherein I left this discussion yesterday. Now let's go back. So this is completed for us completely. I have taken care. Study purpose, I have told you that yes, you will have to pick up a paper. I have this particular paper with me right now. So majority of the cases, I think I have some downloaded ones also, so I can show it to you. For that I will have to go to the Google and let's say this is the paper. Yeah, now here you can see that yes, you have got what I was talking about. You have got background is there, so you are able to understand why the person is doing it. Objectives or aims, sometimes in some of the journals, like for example Emerald, they have got aims or objectives or focus, all the three. Taylor and Francis, they talk about aim or objectives again, so you can pick up. The second thing is methods. So here goes the one that I wanted to discuss and show it to you, that yes, it is from here that you can go ahead and you can talk about it. Okay, so that takes the case for the study purpose. Was the purpose or the research question stated clearly or not? The purpose is usually stated. For example, if I go to this particular paper, they have taken care here introduction. In the introduction only, you can see that the objective is present out here, to identify barriers to treatment of alcohol dependence as perceived by the individual suffering from AUD by means of through a systematic review. Now, if I want to go ahead, study purpose is here, then they are now, you can read further part out here and you will understand where, see, aim has come in. They will be before aim and the method, they would be talking as to why this particular study has been taken care of. For example, here the study selection or identification of the study, why they have done this. So you can understand this absolutely clearly and then you can proceed further from here. Then we have also checked out with the literature. I think I discussed it. Was the relevant background literature reviewed or not, and why it should be taken care of with such a seriousness. The next part wherein I discussed is about the study design also, and we have seen that there are many research designs, the guidelines of the most. Now for qualitative, I'll be showcasing to you what kind of a study design is available and how many varieties of them are there, and for each and every study design, what are the various techniques, what are the various tools. Is it compulsory for Mio, Atlas, Max QDA or NIME or those kind of softwares which are available, or do I have something called as online tools also that I can use, or can I go ahead and use the free and open sources like R Studios and Python, machine learning, all those kind of programming languages which are there, can I use them for performing the study design also? And you will see definitely yes, how to proceed further. Then here they have discussed a lot. Some researchers will not describe, now this is in qualitative, okay, will not describe their study using these study descriptions. They may simply refer to the research as a qualitative design, and in most cases you should expect the authors. However, if you look at Creswell you know, and the discussions which are there in is 3 to 4, I mean he published around 6 books, and one of the book is exclusively on the research design, and you will see as to what he has to say about the research design. design. I will be dealing this particular topic in depth when I'll come over into the qualitative studies, and you will understand the entire thing in a very nice manner. When reviewing articles in which the design is described only as qualitative, it can be useful to consider which of these traditions best matches, okay, the study you are reading. This will help you make the judgment about the appropriateness of design, sampling, data collection, and the analysis. Remember, the all, as I told you, right from the study design till the analysis, all of them are linked with each other. This is the sequence, and you need to follow it up right from the philosophical assumptions till the end, and you cannot just deviate from them. The steps are the same thing. Only thing is that in one you are analyzing it without the numbers, in another you are taking care. However, I'll show you how the qualitative data also can be changed into the numbers, and you can proceed further with the quantitative studies. Now, numerous issues can be considered in determining the appropriateness of the design chosen. Some of the key issues will be in this we will deal in the end, not right now. Next important topic, that is the reason why I am reading line by line, is understanding the design types. Now, first of all, they are talking about the phenomenology, and quite surprisingly, phenomenology is one of the I would say design types which is available in qualitative, and you can really do a very in-depth and a neat way of analyzing your data and collecting your own data in terms of the qualitative. Now, here the question arises, what is it like to have a certain experience? Now, I remember it as a student of philosophy of mind. My first interaction was paper was, what is it like to be a bat? Now, you see, as a student of philosophy of mind, and this paper was recommended, and I was asked to read this paper. First of all, it's a very popular paper, and if you are a very serious student, one should grab and try to understand. And I was thinking, of all the world in this world, why the hell should I focus only on the bat? There are so many things that I would like to do. What is it like to be Deepika Padukone, or what is it like to be Shah Rukh Khan, or let's say, what is it like to be a machine? And in that way, Alexa or Sophia, there are so many things. Or Alita from Cameroon's movie. I mean, I love that character a lot. Now, if you will understand or pick up any other animal or a flower and try to see what is it like to have. Like, I have a lot of pets. So, I'm very fond of pet animals. Now, sometimes I used to think, you know, how does my pet animal Joy and Caesar, they were trying to look at me. And why was it that my mother, if they used to do something wrong, she never used to scold them. You know, she used to scold me, and these two pet dogs of mine, they used to sympathize, and then they used to be animals, you know, without troubling my mother. So this kind of a thing, sometimes I keep wondering, it's enough writing the stories from the human perspective. Let me write the stories from their perspective and see how they are looking at the world of human beings, you know. So these kind of a questions always come up in phenomenology, and you know, you can write a lot of questions and look at the answers later on to find out. And it's a full way of analyzing certain things in your life and then proceed further with the quantitative. Now, it seeks to understand the phenomenon of a live experience. Now, there is a person, you know, from whom I'm learning numerology. Now, I know when I'm learning the numerology, the entire world of numbers, including, you know, there are certain things which I'm not supposed to share here on the public domain. However, you know, certain things are there which I used to think, oh my God, the numbers are able to reveal those things about you a lot on a special day. And I keep wondering, you know, how is it like to be a number in itself? You know, because number itself is a concept which has been, I would say, taken care of by the world of human beings. So what is it like to be a number in itself? Let's say a 9 number or a 8 number or a 6 number. How do you try to understand, interpret yourself? Now, it seeks to understand. Okay, let me come back to this one. It seeks to understand the phenomenon of a lived experience. This may be related to an emotion. Such as loneliness or depression. Now, you see, when now my mother is also not there with me, my father is also not there with me, now I'm all alone. Now, sometimes I feel being all alone is a curse for a human being, or is it a blessing for you? And yesterday I was just trying to answer the query of one of my friends on Facebook, because she wanted to connect me with me on Facebook. So I said, okay, fine, I'm coming over there. And there immediately I saw this flash message, which said that don't worry if you are all alone. Being alone is the most powerful thing in this world. Now, I was wondering why the person is saying it's the most, because I'm an extrovert by nature and a highly socializing kind of a person. And now when suddenly I'm all alone, you know, sometimes I feel, you know, what is it that is different, and how does it make you so powerful? And spiritually, they say that being alone is quite good. However, if I'm a non-spiritual kind of a person, then how should I treat this loneliness to be? You know, so how it becomes more powerful is something, again, one can really understand. So here, loneliness, depression, being in a relationship with a person. Now, that is something which really scares me sometimes, because most of the time I'm being very successful and I'm very happy with some of my friends or my mother. Touch wood, my relationship with my teachers is the superb one. And some of my friends also are really, I have wonderful relationship. However, sometimes I feel, you know, when I see myself interacting, is it the relationship just based upon you only, or you have to understand from the other perspective also? If it is from the other perspective also, then, you know, I lose my freedom completely, and I have to think, okay, how the person is going to think about me? Can I talk to that person in whatever way I feel like, you know, or do I have to be very artificial to that person? Now, there are certain things which you never know. You know, sometimes they might say, okay, no more interaction with you. Now, you know, I sometimes think, okay, at one time we say we are very good friends of each other. On the other side, when we say that, okay, if you are giving me the freedom to talk to you, and suddenly one day I find that, no, you're not free. You have to take a lot of precautions to understand the other person also. So, you know, the relationship when we are talking, or when I'm interacting with some of my friends and they discuss about the relationship, especially the emotional ones, I keep looking at them. And they say, you know, Ramani, when you are in a relationship with somebody, I think you are the most luckiest person that you are not in a relationship with someone. You know, otherwise life becomes like a hell for you, and always you have to make adjustments. And I keep thinking, so does that mean that if you are in a relationship, it means that your freedom is lost? You know, my bosses always used to tell me, you know, when I was working in multi corporations, and then they used to say, never get married in your life. And I used to keep looking at them. I said, why? What is the matter if somebody gets married to? Then they say, you know, the way you're smiling, the way you are. Now, I know some of my live wires, you know, two of my good friends, I would say, they used to tell me, Ramani ma'am, be very careful when you're going to get married to someone. I used to ask them, why? I think the way you smile, the way you talk, everything will be changed after the marriage. So sometimes I wonder, tomorrow if I select a person to get married, and the first thing that I would like to ask him is, why does he want to get married? Does he want me to be changed as per his habit, as per his nature, as per his, just because I'm entering into his house? You know, so there are many questions, and that question itself comes under the brackets of phenomenon. Why I'm discussing all these things is that this is also a phenomenological study sometimes. You need to understand quite a lot of things which are there, or to being a part of an organization or a group. When you join a company, you are given an introduction, which is called as an orientation. Now, in the orientation, they give you everything, including the fact that I know the day I went to give the interview at GE in Gurgaon, the entire day we were asked to reach the premises at sharp 10 o'clock in the morning, and after that they said that they made me wait till 2 o'clock. So from 10 a.m. till 2 p.m. I cannot sit idle, correct? So they used to come back, they used to say, now you can go to our cafeteria, have some breakfast, go ahead and you can take your breakfast. Or the lunchtime was there around 1 o'clock, they said, why don't you go to the cafeteria and have our lunch over there, we welcome you for the lunch. So what are they trying to do? I was wondering. At that time I never realized it, however now I'm able to understand that yes, they're trying to make me observe before I can go to give the interview. What kind of a culture is there? What kind of atmosphere is there? Whether I'm going to be adjusted to that kind of an atmosphere or not. So you know, those things were there, and that is also again understanding. So that comes into the studies of phenomenology. Now it comes from the social sciences and requires a researcher to enter into an individual's life world and use the self to interpret the individual's or group's experience. So I'm not going to talk about relationships, however if we are talking about organization or something, how do you perceive, like I was telling you the case of the hospital in my earlier video, wherein I said that it was me who kept mum, and I somehow alienated myself, and I tried to understand the entire scenario from the doctor's perspective, nurse's perspective, dietitian's perspective, nutritionist perspective, my mother's perspective, and then I was trying to understand as a third person as to what exactly is happening and how do I fit in all of them together into my own model. You know, being a researcher, I should understand all these things also side by side. And then phenomenology's application to the any subject, you can, it's not necessarily that we have to focus only on occupational therapy out here. We can take away this word, I would say, instead of this word that you have got over here, just introduce your own domain. It can be marketing, it can be management, it can be journalism, it can be law, criminology, it can be prison study, migration study, whatever you want to say, partition study, you can carry forward, and then see how well this thing is fits in with the phenomenology. And they have given you this example, however I'm not going to read this particular example. My video especially on phenomenological series, you can have a look at it and you will be able to. I'm not yet uploaded, I need to upload those videos also, and then you will understand the textbooks which are there to understand whether there is just one variety of phenomenology or there are varieties of phenomenology. Then on one hand, your experiences, the textbooks that we have got, the thinkers who introduced those phenomenological schools, how to fit in with your experiences and create the models as per those things. Now that is also something we will understand it. Similarly with ethnography, here they're giving you little bit of introduction to ethnography, and they say that it is a well-known form of qualitative research, especially if you come from the anthropological studies, and there you will see ethnography. What do? They go to that particular place and, for example, and focuses on the question, what is the culture of a group of people? Now, for example, I want to understand the culture of medicine, doctors, the school of nurses. How do they think? How do they interact? What is the meaning of primary care for them? Do they have something called a secondary care? Because you see, these terminologies are also used when you are talking about the government's initiative towards certain things. So you will see that or people in a particular setting. Now, you know, if you set up, it becomes an experimental setup for you. In that time, how do you understand? Now, for example, today I was watching one of the Indian Idol seasons, recent one. Somehow, I like that singer a lot, and I keep listening to her song, especially the way she doodles around, you know, yudli, 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 like Kishore Kumar. And I love those songs kind of a thing. So I was just trying to listen to the conversation with, they had invited Neetu Singh, Rishi Kapoor's wife, and there she was telling me that the song, you know, humne tumko dekha, tumne humko dekha, if you remember that particular song. And she said that when this song was being, I would say, shot in Mehboob Studios, she's recollected that at that time, Randhir ji, that means her relative, in her own family, you know, had the happy news of Karishma Kapoor being born in the family, you know. So she was just sharing, and she said that at that time we never had AC and everything. Giving this kind of a shots was very difficult, especially in a non-AC studio. So, you know, when she was telling, then I was thinking, what kind of Mehboob studios are present? Like, if you have visited some of the studios, like I have seen T-Series studios and how the shooting takes place. I have seen Marwa studios, how it takes place. Then Akineni studios in Andhra, or Ramoji Rao studio at Hyderabad, or L.V. Prasad studio at Chennai. Or if you go to Vishakhapatnam, you can see Indira studio, that is popular Mahesh Babu, who is the most popular hero of South India, especially Andhra Pradesh. If you go to their studios, what exactly it is taking place. So when you are looking these studios, you know, each studio becomes a model for you, and then you are able to understand. Similarly, your setting can be each and every photograph that you are clicking. For you, that's a ethnographical structure. I mean, there are a lot of ways in which we can understand, and we will see how from school to school ethnographical studies are very different and how to understand them. It's a beautiful, again, journey, and entering into that zone means being with me for some time so that we really understand. Now, these kind of a things can be understood to know what kind of a things, to understand groups' daily life. Now, for example, when I go all the way from Delhi to Kurukshetra, I find the place to be so different. Now, I remember it very well. The first thing, because I was craving for something, can I get some bhelpuri, or you know, I'm very fond of this thing. What do you call jhalmuri? You know, I'm so fond of it that sometimes I prepare it at home, and so I thought, okay, I cannot prepare here, so let me purchase it. So I was asking one of the person, you know, what is the most popular street food of Kurukshetra? Now, you know, everybody gave me a look, and one person, he asked me, what do you mean by street food? Now, you know, I got a, like I was zapped completely to understand what is a street food, and now where am I kind of a thing, you know. That was my first reaction, where am I? And I could not somehow come out of it till date. That person asked me this question in return. What do you mean by street food? Now, you know, come to Delhi, and Delhi is full of street food only, you know. And similarly, when I go to Tirupati, the atmosphere is so very different over there. Now, similarly, when I go to Jagannath Puri, you know, Dwarka, or let's say even Agra, whenever I visit Agra, I feel, oh my God, I have come to a very totally a different place. Reason, there are certain reasons, especially with the hygienic conditions, with the pollution over there, and then you know, me getting attracted to Agra because of the historical importance of that place, and I always relish historical things more and more than anything else. So, you know, there are certain ways in which you can understand. Now, similarly, beliefs and social patterns of the groups. Now, for example, when I'm interacting with some tribal people, or you can say if you go to coastal regions of Vishakhapatnam, that is my birthplace, and when you go to the seaport market, it's a totally a different arena wherein, you know, we think that women are very conservative over there. However, when I see women over there, I get a shock of my life. They are so free, and they are least interested, and they're so beautiful and everything.
come to Goa. The Goa culture is so different. The beach markets, especially the Anjuna beach market, or if you go to the Marina beach markets and everything, you see them, the culture is so very different. So how do you understand them at that time and include the material culture on one side, go watch their buildings, tools and other objects that have cultural meaning. Now if you go to Kashmir especially, I find out the entire atmosphere. I did not even board the flight. People say be very careful when you are going there and do not show your Jhansi Ki Rani attitude over there. I just keep looking at them. I say, what kind of a setting are they trying to prepare for me and sending me to Kashmir? However, my first interaction over there when I visited, I understood the whole thing. I could see the dichotomy, what is happening over there and why. So, you know, ethnographical things, if you are just reading, will never ever give you the true feeling of writing that particular paper. You know, who are the editors especially, they will catch hold of you if you have created the ethnographic scenario for yourself without the actual experience. So when you are experiencing and you are able to narrate it or put it in the form of your research, you will be able to understand. So culture is not limited to ethnic groups or an ethnographic study, the culture of organizations. The study of organizations is wonderful. Now, we say that GE is a multinational, it's an MNC. Convergys is an MNC, so is Dell, IBM and everything. So, how do you differentiate between these MNCs? So, each company turns out to be your model. So, how do you differentiate it? Now, that's where the ethnography would be coming in. So, if you ask me, okay, you worked there for 8 years. Can you please tell us more about what is it like working in GE? So, you know, my experience, my exposure of that particular company, especially working at Gurgaon premises as well as Jaipur. Now, these are the two places where I worked, and I know, you know, what are the differences from Gurgaon to Jaipur, and what is happening at Jaipur, and what is taking place in Gurgaon, and how the culturally they are different. So, you know, you can understand this kind of a stuff at all. Now, for example, if you most of you are so much interested in writing spiritual papers, and the model, you have Brahma Kumaris, you have Isha Foundation, Sadhguruji's model, you have got Ravi Shankara, Sri Ravi Shankaracharya ji is there. You can pick up Jiddu Krishnamurti or any other spiritual guru that you have got, and you try to understand the culture, how it is, why is it, then maybe you can come up with certain things that you are really able to know and experience and put them into the writing format. So example, they have given it. Now in the same manner, they're going ahead with the grounded theory. Now here they have explained to you so that when you are going to write your answers or your response on the review form, when I'm talking about review form, I'm talking about the form which I showed it in my earlier video, and how do you understand a phenomenological thing or ethnographical, and here comes the grounded theory. Though I'm giving you a very superficial kind of an introduction, however, when you really study, now for example, they are talking about Glaser and Strauss, then Sharma's, then comes your Strauss and Corbin. Now, unless and until you haven't read, how can you go ahead and say that, yes, I'm applying this kind of thing into the research? That cannot be possible. So first try to understand what the model is all about, how the model is working, what are the various variables which are present over there, come up with your own codes, your themes, and then go ahead and talk to them. And in that itself, you will see some are talking about becoming more objectivist out here. Can you see? Now the objectivist theories are very, very different from the what I will call it as the subjectivist theories. Now see, there are three varieties that you have to remember. Purely subjective theories are also there. Purely objective theories are also present. Then there is a mixed combination of subjective and objective theories also. So you need to understand these basic philosophical things to know, and then proceed further with your research selection of your study design. Before that, you will have to understand understand where I am into basically. Okay, so here they're talking about being more objectivist, or what you call it as the positivistic. I would go ahead more and say
it is the logical positivism that you are talking about. Similarly, when you come to the constructivist kind of a thing, you are on the terms of interpretivism.
Or later on, when I'll be discussing, you can know more about descriptivism. Like if you read Descartes' Meditations, there he comes up with his own dictum, wherein he says, "I think, therefore I am."
Now, I keep wondering, why he says always, "I think, therefore I am." So, you know, there are a lot of descriptivism that is involved over there, and your schools of law and legal studies, there, you know, you can see the manner they are trying to interpret certain things when they do the qualitative research in terms of Cartesian dualism. Now, we will understand these terminologies as I keep coming up more, and we will know them also side by side. So grounded theory method is an emergent, now you see slowly they are developing. So they say that humans are going ahead with human agency, social and subjective meaning, problem solving practices and action. Grounded theory method is an emergent design dependent on the continuous data analysis. So it is not just one go you have done and you get the grounded theory. There is that churning which is taking place. Now churning means out here, jaise hum log makhan nikalte hain. You know, you keep on churning, and you get a better butter is being taken care of, and the end result is really good. The same thing happens in the grounded theory, and we will definitely learn more about it in my next. Whenever I introduce the videos on the qualitative analysis. Next comes what you call it as the participatory action research. This is very important, also called as PAR. It's an approach to the research and the social change. What do you mean by that? Here it means that it involves individuals, groups which are present over here, and researching their own personal feelings, socio-cultural settings and experiences. For example, if I want to understand why all the farmers, the Kisan Andolan, jo we were experiencing in Delhi NCR, why? So unless and until you do not go and sit near those farmers, try to understand why they want to do this kind of a strike or a revolt. They are against the new agricultural laws when the academics was all together and they were supporting them, whereas this particular class, which was really working and the laws were meant for them, they were deadly against it. So why this kind of a dichotomy occasion was taking place? We need to understand even that also. They reflect on their values. So if we are not at that moment, it is not just me who has to think. I need to understand what are the values, the share related. Now usually it happens for me when I am with my friend, I'm always looking from her perspective. I never compel myself on her. If she's angry, okay, fine, she's angry, I just go and tell her. I try to understand why she's angry, what for. And next time whenever I'm interacting with her, it's not Ramini who's interacting, it is Ramini in terms of her friend. She's interacting with her friend basically. So you know, participatory action research is also something like that. And you know, in society we have those kind of individuals who are existing at that time. You know, you never know what, how we are going to adopt and try to be different. And we get, for example, at home when your parents are there. Now with your parents, you will see that with your, if you are very free with your father, you are completely free. I mean, you can talk to them in whatever way you want. You can be very angry with them. You can show. However, if you think that your mother is very strict, I'm a little bit artificial, you will even think twice. Should I smile? Should I talk to that person? Now, it usually happens with my teachers. If you put me in front of my teachers, I'm absolutely a free person because they never stopped me from doing anything, and they gave me the freedom to raise certain question, ask the question which I could not find the answers anywhere, and discuss with them whatever I want.
You know, I have that kind of, and even if I'm angry, I can showcase to them. And I think if somebody knows Ramini more, it is them. Now, similarly, if I come to my parents, I in front of them, I'm a bit artificial because I know, you know, that they may not like me being absolutely free, though I am free sometimes. However, you think twice, and in front of the other individual, you though have to think how the other person will take you. Your freedom is lost altogether. Even if they assume that yes, we are giving her so much of freedom, it's not a freedom actually. You have taken away my freedom also, side by side. So, you know, these kind of things are always present, and understanding PAR in itself becomes really beautiful way to again do a nice qualitative research work. Now, when we come to the other forms, you will see the other designs. I'm so sorry. These are many other qualitative research. The five are the most famous ones which Creswell had taken over, and when my mail communication with him, I asked him, he said that across the world, Ramini people are more interested in these ones, and doing these five designs in itself takes a heavy lot for them. If I introduce the other schools, though I'm not against them, we do it now, for example, structuralism, post-structuralism, Harmonoids, all those kind of a things, and I'll be showcasing to you some more. And you will see that Creswell has very well said, yes, one must understand even them and combine two or three schools of the qualitative designs, and then you know, studies must be motivated, number one, and they should be encouraged for the individual. So here you will see you have got the designs like heuristics, it's a most dangerous area, then ethnomethodology, then institutional ethnography, which is more popular, and I see the students who are more into OCB, you know, they prefer this particular area to go ahead and know them. Then comes my favorite area, hermeneutics, then ecological psychology, that is very important, which I was discussing in the school, what kind of a setup is there for the student. Now, why is that the student is more free with one teacher rather than with the other teacher? Similarly, they are not free with their parents, let it be father or mother, maybe with the tutor. You know, why these differences are coming in. Similarly, my area again, wherein I focus more, is feminism again. And there are so many schools of feminism, radical, liberalism, post-colonial, colonial, I don't know, modernism, post-modernism. There's so many of them. And I belong to the traditional Indian schools, I should say. And our country itself has got so many that you need to focus on them also. Similarly, you have got social interactionism also, side by side, wherein that is another design. And one can, now apart from this, there are some more schools are there, maybe in my qualitative research modules you can have a look at it. Now depending, these are the important study designs for qualitative. Now, what about the appropriateness? I mean, what does this mean? This means that which one of these things do you think is the best one suitable for you? How do you make a test? Now, that is also there. Now, we give you the details about how to choose if you want to go ahead for the study design on phenomenology or ethnography or grounded theory or focus group or PAR or feminism or a combination of these two schools. How you're going to do, that is also present for us. So here, they have given you some of the steps which are more similar, I should say, from Creswell's discussion also. This one I'll start discussing in my next video. So I'll stop here. Let me come up in my next video, wherein I'll start off with the study design and we will understand it more. Thank you for watching. Take care. Bye.